Well, good morning, Foothill. If you're outside, come on in. If you're inside, stand to your feet. Welcome to church. We're going to start with some singing this morning. We sing this morning, church, to remind us of God's faithfulness. We can trust Him.
Overwhelmed, but I won't break. Through the battle, I will say, Your grace will be enough. Your grace will be enough. Under fire, but we won't fall. We will never be alone. You'll always be enough. You'll always be enough. Now in God we trust. In His name we hope. I know God will not be shaken. God is here. He's already won, and I know God will not be shaken.
We make this our prayer, church. We will follow.
And we will follow where You go. We will trust in the unknown. I know You go before. I know, yes, lead my heart now in Your ways, for we're carrying Your name, Your promise never,
yes, sing that out,
Your promise never fails, now in God we trust, in His name.
Your blood poured out, my Savior raised, it was my death. Still and all alone.
Let's pray. God, thank you so much for what you've done for us. Thank you for sending your son Jesus in our place as redemption for us and our sins. And I pray that as your word is open in a moment, you would open our eyes, you would open our ears to clearly hear and see the gospel that is proclaimed to us today. God, we love you. We thank you for all you've done for us. It's in your name we pray. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Well, welcome to church this morning. If you're an adult, you can have a seat. If you are a kid, kindergarten through fifth grade, this is your time. Back entrance, got some great volunteers back there ready to take you to your service. So kindergarten through fifth graders, you may exit through the back doors. A great volunteer is going to take you to your room through the lobby. Everyone else, welcome to church this morning. We're glad you're here. Welcome. Excellent. Well, good morning, Foothill. How's everyone doing? Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day, Jill, and all the awesome mothers in the room. You are awesome. My wife and the mother of five is at the other campus finishing over there leading worship. So it's going to be a great day with us. We're going to go home and celebrate and treat her well. And I hope you guys do the same thing for your wives and moms today. So welcome to church. My name's Shane, and I'm one of the pastors here at church. And it's just great to be singing with you guys, be here with you at church this morning. And it's a great day to spend Mother's Day here, right? Yes. So what you saw in the video, Run for Their Lives, is coming up in just a few weeks from now, June 4th. Fifth is a Sunday. June 4th is coming up. So, hey, we need sponsors. We need volunteers. We need runners. So r4tl.org, that's the place to go. Go there. You can go there right now if you'd like on your tablet or smartphone. You can register to be a sponsor. If you have a small business you want to promote, it's a great way to help us cover some of the costs of the race so that all the money can go to support Redeeming Love. Redeeming Love is an organization in our area that helps rescue women in our area out of the sex trafficking industry. So that's what all this is for. We want to raise money and awareness to help victims of this horrific thing in our neighborhood and in our world. So make sure to do that. R4TL.org. You're going to be hearing a lot about that over the next few weeks. But we want everyone in this room to be running or volunteering or sponsoring at some point. So make sure R4TL.org. If this is your first or second time with us, I want to welcome, a special welcome to you. There's an orange connection card in the seat back in front of you. Take that out. Fill it out as completely as possible. This is like our guest book. Just fill it out and then take it with you. Black Info Tent in outside in the plaza area is our Black Info Tent where there's some great volunteers to answer questions for you. You can take this with you afterwards and give it to them. They'll have some gifts they're going to give you to say thanks for coming to Foothill today and some information about the church. It's not a bait and switch. They're not going to make you sign up for anything or join a club or anything like that. They just want to say welcome to church and answer any questions you may have. So if you have any questions after service, head there. If you want to know what the next step is, you're like, hey, I've been coming to Foothill for, I don't know, this may be your first week, or you've been coming for months and you still haven't really got connected in anything. Foothill 101 is a great class. The next class is Sunday, June 5th. The first weekend of every single month, we offer this class at every single service at both campuses. So wherever you're attending that day, you can attend that class. It's a great class that just kind of gives some brief overview of Foothill, some of our history, some ministry overview, kind of where your next step for growth can begin. So getting involved and getting connected. Again, with that class, it's a no-pressure class. They're not going to make you join any sort of club or group or anything like that, but they'll give you some options of things to of next steps for you. So at least you kind of know where the next step is for you after that. Okay? Well, ushers, you can get ready. We're going to take receive our morning tithes and offerings this morning. And before I dig into that, just a couple of quick things on how to do that. Offering envelope is a great way to do that. Right in front of you, you can put your cash or check or debit card on the inside of that. You wouldn't put the debit card inside. You'd write your information about it. It'd be weird. Foothillchurch.net/give online is a great way. And then my favorite, text to give, I do every 2 weeks when I get paid. I simply text it in and it's done. It's so great. It's really helped me be more faithful in my giving to make it more regular. I don't carry a checkbook around with me. And so anyway, some great ways to do that. But if you're new to church and you're like, what is tithes and offerings? I think it'd be great just for us to remember where it all started. Numbers chapter 18, verse 20 to 21. This is kind of where the tithes came from. So back in the country or the people of Israel, there were 12 tribes or 12 sons. And one of the sons' name was Levi. And Levi, on all his clan, called the Levites, they were in charge of the tabernacle or the temple later on. And they didn't get any inheritance of land. All the other tribes got land given to them. Levites didn't get that. The way that they supported themselves was through tithes, that all the other tribes would tithe to the Levites so that the Levites could carry on the tasks of ministry at the tabernacle. So it says this, the Lord said to Aaron, you shall have no inheritance. This is what I'm talking about. No inheritance in their land. Neither shall you have any portion among them. I am your portion and your inheritance among the people of Israel. To the Levites, that's the priests in the tabernacle and the temple, I have given every tithe in Israel for an inheritance in return for their service that they do, their service in the tent of meeting. So for what they did in serving in the tabernacle and serving in later on in the temple, what they received was tithe from the people to help support them so they could could make a living and still survive and have food and all that kind of stuff. So we carry this tradition on. This is where this practice and worship of giving in the church really originated from, is from God setting it up for his people. And so we today, I come up here and we say, we're going to receive this morning our tithes and our offerings, and it's to help support the ministry of what happens. Now, we don't call this a tabernacle today, but we call this a church, but it's the same idea that you support the ministries that happen here at this church that, you know, run for their lives, we just talked about. Our missions and outreach director, Kelly Shakirian, has been working on it for months, lining up sponsors and the run route through Glendora and how it's all going to work and aligning ourselves with redeeming. I mean, months and months. But your giving has allowed her to do that, supported her to be able to, her to work full time on doing things like that. And it just goes down the road. I see like Pastor Steve, like he does full time with our youth and being able to minister to them. And saw him sitting out here with a bunch of youth last service, talking and hanging out with them. I mean, what he's able to do is focus on his attention because of what you guys do in giving. So thank you for your support and your giving. What you do is helping to expand the gospel in this community, in this region, around this area. So thank you for your support. And it's not just support, but it's worship to God. It's how God set it up back then. It's how God determines for it to be now, that we worship him with our giving. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. God, we love you. We thank you so much. We thank you that you have given so much to us, and we in turn want to give it back to you. You own everything. Anything that we already have is already yours, God, and we just give a small portion back to you. God, separately today, I just want to pray a blessing on all the mothers this morning. Thank you for the role they play in our lives as wives and mothers to our kids. And also, God, I want to pray for those in our church who are longing to be a mother yet have not been able to yet. God, I pray for comfort for them. I pray you'd comfort them this time as they look around and longing to become a mother, and that in due time, God, you would supply that desire in their life through any means that you see necessary. God, we thank you. Thank you for the role that the women who play in our lives as children and as husbands. God, we love you, Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Ushers, you can go ahead.
My name is Lu Chishi. Currently, we are living in Thailand as missionaries and reaching out to the people in China, Burma, and Thailand through discipleship program. Especially in China right now, there are so many pastors, leaders, but they are untrained. The churches are very spiritually poor. They really need our help to be able to equip them and train them and raise them up. So the Lord has really given me a burden, passion to help training our people to become our disciples, to train the others. We are really reaching out to many leaders, many church pastors, training these disciples to be able to get the message to the people who are really living in the darkness of the world. Many of our pastors, leaders under Asian Frontier Outreach right now, they are doing a lot of church planting among many unreached people group. God is really moving in such a mighty and beautiful way. The Lord has called us to focus on the orphan children who have no parents because the life is very desperate in Myanmar. Many people are very much underprivileged, so the poverty is huge. So we are also expecting more children to come to be a part of this home. We appreciate your prayer and your financial support as a kingdom partners in order to continue the work in Southeast Asia, and your friendship and your relationship encouragement is truly a blessing to all of us in Asia. We really thank you for your support and for your partnership in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, good morning, Foothill. Am I on? Check, 1, 2. Hey, good to see you all here. Happy Mother's Day. And in honor of you, I wore a suit. So here you go. Because if my mom were here, she'd like that. So it's good to see you all. Pastor Lou is a friend. He's been a friend of the church. We've supported him for several years now. I've actually gone on 2 trips where Pastor Lou hosted us. I went to the border of Myanmar, which same thing as Burma he talked about, and Thailand, and did some pastoral training there. And then went to China a couple of years ago, and we went really far out into a remote city and did some pastoral training there as well. And it was just an unbelievable experience. Pastor Lou is an amazing guy. You actually will have a chance to meet him afterwards. He'll be out at our missions and outreach area. And I really encourage you to go and shake his hand and tell him thank you. I mean, to be with Pastor Lou is a little bit like, I feel like it must have been like to be with Billy Graham back in the early days. Not me, with him. He's a guy that just when he shows up in town to some of these remote villages, literally hundreds, even thousands of people will show up to hear him, to receive teaching from him. He opens his Bible, and we love the Bible here, and so I love that Pastor Lou does that. I mean, he just wants to equip the church in China and Myanmar, both still closed countries, and yet somehow by God's grace, he's been given access into those countries. And so it's a really remarkable thing that God has opened this door for Pastor Lou. And so I want to encourage you to do two things. I want to encourage you to just shake his hand, tell him thank you. We support him as a church. I want to encourage you also to consider, some of you, this may be like, man, this feels like it's really close to home for me, or this feels like something, I love this kind of thing, and I would love to support Pastor Lou. So we support him as a church, and we will continue to. But I want to encourage some of you, you'd say, I want to take him on as some of my own personal support in something else that I do besides just giving to the church. And if you'll do that, I mean, that's one way we can expand the ministry that Pastor Lou has. I mean, the fact of the matter is, you and I, very, very few of us are going to go to the places that he is able to go and minister to the people that he ministers, not just because we live so far away, the language barrier, all kinds of things, but he's there. And it's amazing what God is doing. The souls that are being won to Christ, the orphanage that he runs, the ministry he's doing to pastors and leaders in the Chinese and Thai and Burmese churches. It's really a wonderful thing. And so I encourage you to get involved in that today, okay? All right. Well, I'm going to ask if Matt and Val Glidden will come. And they're bringing a little Elijah. And along with them are moms and dads and grandparents and everybody coming. We've got Val's mother, Patricia, Val's brother, Emmanuel, Matt's parents, John and Wendy, and Matt's brother and fiance, Chris and Maria. Welcome. We're really glad you're here. And come on out here. We'll get everybody up on the stage here. This is awesome. So if this is new for you, this is not a child. We don't baptize infants, but it is something that we dedicate to the Lord. We believe that's a biblical practice according to Mark chapter 10 that we're supposed to receive the little children and as a community come around them and pray for them and ask God to set His hand upon them. And so we want to do that. And in fact, I want to grab my Bible here and talk to you guys. Let's get a picture. Hi, how are you? Good to see you. Look right back there, and we'll get a picture. Okay? Right on. There we go. Well, this is awesome. This is awesome. Guys, I was thinking about you this morning, and let me just read something to you. So in the book of Proverbs is written for children. And so you, at a young age, I hope that you'll start to expose Elijah to the Proverbs. But you know that Proverbs says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. Then the writer of Proverbs, Solomon, goes on to say something interesting. He says, hear, my son, your father's instruction. Forsake not your mother's teaching, for they are a graceful garland for your head and pendants for your neck. My son, now he's talking to Elijah, if sinners entice you, do not consent. If they say, come with us, let us lie in wait for blood. Let us ambush the innocent without reason. Like Sheol, let us swallow them alive and whole, like those who go down to the pit. We shall find all precious goods. We shall fill our houses with plunder. Throw in your lot among us. We will all have one purse. And it goes on and on. And it's just this very, like, this would be awful if this happened to my child. But I want you to hear is the allure of false community. And what the reason a child, the reason any child goes in that direction very often is because there's another community begging for their attention, receiving them, saying, we'll love you. And so part of what your responsibility as parents is to introduce them and keep them. Somebody said, show me your friends, I'll show you your future, right? And that's so true of our walk with Christ. Show me Elijah's friends and we'll see his future, right? And you want him to walk with God. Elijah, if I've got this right, means my God is the Lord. And what an amazing, amazing picture. Make that your desire for him for the rest of your life. And if you do that, then I'm confident that we're going to see Elijah walk with the Lord the rest of his life, okay? Let me grab him and we'll pray. You want to come to me, buddy? You good? Oh, look at this guy. Hi. Hi, Smiley. Oh. Well, you are a cute little kid. Hi. Hi. Well, let's do this. Congregation, reach out your hand toward this family and let's pray. Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, and we just thank you for little Elijah. We thank you, God, that you've set your hand upon him. And I just pray, God, that at a very young age, he would respond to the grace of God in his life, that, Lord, you'd save him, that he would come to know you as his Lord and Savior. And, Lord, I pray that he would have friends, biblical, gospel, Jesus-loving friends that would surround him and be a community that would encourage him in his faith. I pray for Matt and Val. I pray, God, help them as parents. Lord, I pray that you'd give them great wisdom beyond their years. And I pray, God, that that very early on they'd begin to instruct Elijah in the ways of the Lord, and that he would hear and he would believe and he'd be saved. So, Lord, you would save him even now from a life of rebellion, that he would never look back and see rebellion in his past, but, God, he would grow to have a boring testimony where he could say, I've known Jesus saved me at a young age and I've followed him all the days of my life. Do it, we pray. We love you, Jesus. We thank you for it. And we ask this in your name. Everybody said, amen. Oh, got him. Just in time. Just in time. There you go. Well, thank you, guys. That's awesome. Let's give him a hand. I got something for you, Val. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Yeah. All right. That's awesome. Well, let's grab our Bibles and go to Matthew chapter 6, and we're going to finally make it through the rest of chapter 6, not the Sermon on the Mount, but chapter 6, verses 25 to 34 we're going to look at today. According to the National Institute of Mental Health, 40 million people suffer from some kind of anxiety. So that would be something like 1 in 5 adults in this room suffer from some sort of diagnosable, apparently, anxiety. If you add children to that, the number goes up to 1 in 4, so from 20 to 25%. And this is not just anxiety or worry about my casserole burning or my team not making the playoff. This is a kind of debilitating, a sort of fear in the pit of the stomach, the kind of thing that distracts you and keeps you from being able to focus. It causes ulcers. It does this in our hearts and in our minds, and actually can cause even other illnesses sometimes. The truth of the matter is we have a lot that we could be anxious about, right? Some of us are anxious about our children, like what's going to happen with my children? We're anxious about our careers. Am I going to have the career that I dream of? Or is there even a job available to me? What's happening in the economy? What in the world is going to happen in November when we elect a new president? What's going to happen in the United States of America? I'm worried about life decisions. I'm worried about the debt that I have to carry. I'm worried about jobs. I'm worried about parents. I'm worried about children. I'm worried, and we could go on and on. And some of you are like, please don't. Because now I'm really worried and I want to leave, right? So before you do, just hear me say this. Hear Jesus say this. He doesn't want you to worry. Jesus wants to come and help you with anxiety and worry. That's an amazing thing. You know, the gospel isn't just, it's a ticket you know, to get out of here and have some home in heaven. That's true. That's true. There is a home in heaven being prepared for you. If you believe in Jesus Christ, there is eternal life that's waiting for you. But that eternal life starts now. And that means that Jesus wants to help you now. And part of his helping you is saying, I don't want you to be so overcome by anxiety. I want to help you overcome anxiety. And this is incredibly good news, right? That's the gospel. But the gospel is good news for our future, but it's good news for today. So I want us to just start in chapter 6, verse 25, and we'll just start reading and unpack it a little bit and then just keep walking our way through this, okay? So I'm looking at Matthew chapter 6, verse 25, and the first word in my Bible at that point is therefore. Now, I'm not going to do this with every word, I promise you, or we'd be here till next week. But we got to stop. That's a big word in Scripture. Therefore, because what it means, just like we use it in the English language, it means that we're drawing some conclusions. We're saying in conclusion or in light of what I just said, this is true. So Jesus is saying, I need you, I want you to believe the truths that I've just preached to you. And if you'll believe those truths, then you'll come to the same conclusion that I've come to. Okay, so what were those truths? Remember that? He said, don't lay up for yourself treasures on earth, but lay it up in heaven. So he said, here's a truth, that you realize there is a treasury in heaven that is better than anything you could ever invest here in here on earth. He said, there's a couple of perspectives you can have. The true one is an eternal perspective that is full of light, and the other one is a perspective that's full of darkness and deceit. And he wants you to believe in the eternal perspective. He says there's also two masters. There's a master that is God, who's gracious and good and merciful, and there's the master of following your heart and going after money and going after possessions and things like that. And he says, you've got a choice to make. And he's saying, here's the truths. And you won't draw the conclusions that Jesus draws until you're convinced of the truths that Jesus is convinced of. That's what he's telling us. Just in this word, therefore, I'm going to now bring this thing to a conclusion. Now, what's the conclusion that he draws? In light of everything he's just said, look what he says, verse 25 again. Therefore, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. What's the message? Don't be anxious. I don't want you to be anxious. I don't want you to worry. I don't want there to be this consuming concern for you. And by the way, he's going to say it three times. He says it in 25. He says it in verse 31. He says it again in verse 34. I think you, right? He's like, I want you to get the point. Don't worry. Don't be anxious. Don't be concerned, right? Now, there's a couple of ways you can hear Jesus saying, don't worry. You can hear it like an angry person. Don't worry. Come on. Stop. Don't do that. Or you can hear it the way that I think the context demands you hear it. And that is that ever since he started chapter 6, he starts referring to God as what? A father. Over and over and over again. He's a father. He's a father. He's a father. He's a father. In other words, what he's saying to you is here's a dad looking at a child who's overcome with anxiety and saying, son, daughter, come to me. Like I've got this. I'm bigger than this. I can handle this for you. You don't have to carry this. I want to carry it for you. But you're all worried. Your stomach's in knots. Your shoulders are all tight. The muscles, I mean, you got to go get a massage. You're so worried, right? You got to have somebody do like deep muscle tissue stuff because you're just so tightened up with worry. He says, come here. Come and just sit on my lap. And I love you. And I'm concerned for you. Cast all your anxieties upon me because I care for you. That's the voice you should hear. So why do we do this? I bet every person in this room, to one degree or another, somewhere along this spectrum, we worry. Some of us, it's clinical. Some of us, it's all the way down. Just I worry just about little things in life and all along this spectrum. Why? Like, what's going on in our hearts? I think sort of fundamentally, one of the reasons we worry is because we think we have to. Nobody else will. So I have to worry about what I've got to worry because I'm the only one who can carry this. Not even God can carry. So I've got to step into God's territory. I've got to do God's job because God won't care for me. God won't worry for me the way that I do. But what are we doing? We don't remember that God's a father. We just don't remember that he's a loving father. He's all powerful. He's all good. He never stops doing good. He wants to help us. We just forget that all the time. You understand that when he says, don't be anxious, three times, don't be anxious, don't be anxious, all three of those are commands. This is not an option. This is not saying, hey, I think this is a good idea for you just not to worry. Now, it isn't a good idea. But it's a command, and to disobey any command of Scripture is a sin. But hear this. There can be a command that says it's sinful for you to disobey, and you can hear that as God with a club wanting to club you, or you can hear it as a merciful, gracious God going, I don't want this for you. This is killing you. Don't do it. So what is worry? Have you ever thought about what is going on in worry? Worry is simply concern about, if you will, tomorrow. This is what Jesus says, right? He says, don't worry about tomorrow. Don't worry about what you will eat or will drink or will put on. I mean, those are all future tense. So what am I doing? I'm worried about things that are in my future. In other words, I'm worried. I've got anxiety today about things that will happen tomorrow. I'm worried about a meeting that I might have this week. I'm worried about my children and how they're going to turn out in 10 years. I'm worried about, you know, what's going to happen in November. I'm worried about stuff that's happened tomorrow. I mean, the cause may be something in the past. I may have done something that makes me now worry about, but it's rippling into my future and it's causing me uncertainty, and so I'm worried. See, worry is simply my attempt to control my world, to control the uncontrollable. What's that? The future. I can't control the future, but I try. You know what happens is when we worry, we step into God's shoes. And here, let's just say it this way. Anytime you try to take over God's role in your life, you should worry. You have everything in the world to worry about because you can't carry it. I can't, you can't, nobody can. God can carry it. And so we're going to him, right? I'm trying to be God for my world. And what does that do? That creates worry. Why? Because I get in and I'm okay. I've got to worry about tomorrow because, oh no, and I'm trying to think through everything and I want to make sure everything's right. And so I'm worried and I'm trying to carry that. And then I realize I can't carry it. And so because I can't do the very thing that I'm trying to do, man, it produces all kinds of anxiety in me. So Jesus just steps into that space of your life and says, don't worry. Now, you know what? He's Jesus. He could stop right there, and he doesn't. Because the rest of the time, he's going to give you reasons why you don't have to worry. And these are like bedrock, good, grounding reasons. He says, here's why you don't have to worry. I love that Jesus does this, by the way. He doesn't just say, don't, stop. He says, let me tell you why. Let me give you reasons. And here's what I want to make sure you hear me on this. He gives these reasons to his followers. That's a really important that you hear this. If you're a follower, praise God. If you're not a Christian, I want you to hear me loud and clear. I'm so glad you're here, and I'm glad you're listening in, and I hope something that's said today will whet your appetite and give you a desire to become a follower of Jesus Christ. But I can't tell you these are promises for you. Jesus is not making generic, he's not giving sort of a generic answers to problems relative to worry to the rest of the world. He's not saying, hey, world, here's how you deal with worry. He's not. He's saying, hey, Christian, hey, child of God. Here's some anchors that you can hold on to. Here's some things that God is saying to you. Here are truths that you must reckon with. If you're outside of that, I hope you'll come inside to that today. Okay? So let me give you some reasons that Jesus gives us. Why shouldn't a Christian be anxious? I'm going to give you six things. Some of you maybe find more. But here's what he says. Christian, your life is more than material security. Okay, so look what he did there. I tell you, don't be anxious about your life, what you'll eat, what you'll drink, or about your body, what you'll put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Right now, the word life there, we have a couple of words that we've borrowed from the Greek to get this word, the word life. So he doesn't use the normal word for life, which is bios, biology, right? He uses another word for life, psuche, psychology. Now, he's not using in the sense that we have that word psychology, but what he is saying is that your life is more. It's not just what is on the outside. It's inside, outside. It's all of you. See, many, many religions will split you down the middle and say you are material and you are spiritual, right? You're a body and you're a soul. And those two things we feed and we look at differently. So if I'm a Buddhist monk, for example, then I'm on a higher spiritual plane. And part of the reason I'm on a higher spiritual plane is because I've denied my body. I've said I'm going to forsake all my worldly goods, and that's going to elevate my spirit. And now I'm going to sort of float above the rest of you commoners. I'm not ordinary like you because I've done this. The Bible never talks like that. The Bible doesn't talk about and says you got to forsake all worldly goods and you know they're bad, they're awful, they're evil. It doesn't talk like that. It just says they need to be in their right place. I mean, Jesus basically is saying, you have greater needs. Do you understand this, Christian? You have greater needs than food, than drink, than clothing, than having a good body. You have greater needs than that. Now that's incredible that was written 2,000 years ago, because that feels like that could be written on May 8th, 2016 in Southern California. Because I promise you, just go to the grocery store today, and as you check out, we're just trying to hide these from our children, look at the magazines. Because the magazines will say in one way or another, like, you should be eating this. You should be drinking this kind of beer. If you were a really awesome person, you'd be dressed like this, and your body would look like that. And if these things are not true of you, then you're missing out in this world. I mean, this is everywhere. This is every advertisement. But this is the life. This is the blessed life. This is the good life. This is how you live life to the fullest. So no wonder I feel anxiety, because I don't look like that person, and I don't eat like that person, and I don't drink like that person, and I don't dress like that person. And apparently that's the ultimate that I'm supposed to be after. And now you add to that our age of social media. Which all that is, I mean, it's just crazy to me, right? 90% of social media is, look at what I'm wearing. Look at my awesome food. Do you eat awesome food like I do? Do you see what I'm swirling in my hand? I'm a party guy and girl, and you would be lucky to have this drink right now, right? I mean, do you see my pursed lips and my perfect hair? Like, this is unbelievable. And so no wonder. So you got young people looking at this who are like this is apparently it. And Jesus comes along and says, time out. Drink is good. Food is good. Clothing is good. Everybody should wear clothing, right? It's good. It's just not ultimate. It's just not ultimate. And your life is more than that. There's something better than food. There's something better than drink. There's something better than clothing. And don't make those your highest pursuit like the rest of the world. That's the first thing. Christian, your life is more than material security. The second thing is, Christian, you're more important to God than any other part of his creation. Now I love this. Look at verse 26. Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? Skip down to verse 28. And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Let me just step back with me just for a second. There's a Latin term that we use to describe an argument like that. Maybe some of you have heard this. It's called an a fortiori argument. That's a fancy way of saying this, that if the lesser is true, the greater is also true. So we just read one a little while ago, Romans chapter 5, where he says that if while we were still enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more, a fortiori, much more shall we be reconciled, shall be saved by his life. Okay? Let me do a simpler one. How many of you, don't leave me hanging here, remember the Hey Mikey Life cereal commercial? Come on. Okay, young people, ask your parents. Okay? Okay, here's what happened. I'll describe the commercial to you so they don't have to, okay? Three boys sitting at a table, little boys. Mom comes up and puts Life cereal in front of them. They're all like, ooh, gross. Hey, I got an idea. Let's give it to Mikey. He won't eat it. He doesn't eat anything. They push it in front of Mikey. What happens? Mikey, ooh, 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 I like. And he starts eating. I'm like, hey, Mikey, he likes it, right? What's the argument of the commercial? If Mikey likes it, who hates everything, much more will everybody else like it. And we all bought the product. Right? Okay, this is exactly, now listen to hear Jesus saying. Look at the birds. Look at the grass. If God feeds and clothes them, how much more will he feed and clothe you? You are of so much more value than they are. Do you see this? Now, let's look at it from a different angle. He says this. He says, you know how you do this? He says, look at the birds. Consider the lilies of the field, the grass. That's what he's talking about. And just look at it. I bet nobody in this room has done this. He's talking about, like, you just are watching. Like, look at that bird. And you're journaling, and God's teaching you things about a bird. And you bend down, and you're like, look at that grass. It's not working hard, and it's beautiful. You know what he's saying? He's saying God has surrounded you. I mean, he's given you living illustration after illustration that is screaming to you that God provides for these. Won't he provide for you? So you're walking around Glendora near the foothills, and you hear the whoa, 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 and then yeah, you know, they got a kill. You can feel creeped out. Or if there were possible to put a coyote translation collar on them, I wonder what we would hear. Thank you, Jesus. You did it again. My family's not going to starve again tonight. If God does that for them, won't he do it for you? That's the whole idea. Look, consider, think. Look at how Martin Luther says this. You see, he's making the birds our schoolmasters and teachers. It is a great and abiding disgrace to us that in the gospel a helpless sparrow should become a theologian and a preacher to the wise men. Whenever you listen to a nightingale, therefore, you're listening to an excellent preacher. And then Charles Spurgeon comes along later and says, lovely lilies, how you rebuke our foolish nervousness. So true. Don't you know you're more valuable than they are? Do you believe that? Because if you're a Christian and you believe I'm more valuable, won't God care for me? How many Christians in this room would be able to say, I could tell you time and time and time and time and time again how God provided for me? The gracious good hand of God provided for all my needs. And I was so worried. Number three, he says, Christian, your anxiety isn't going to make you live any longer. We think it will. Right? Look at verse 27. And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life, to his lifespan? Okay, here's the idea. Some of your translations say something like, which of you, by worrying, can add a foot or inches or a cubit, it might say, to your height? Okay, so translators sort of wrestle with this. The idea is your life, okay? He's talking about your life. He's not talking about how tall or short you are. He's talking about the length of your life, but he uses this word cubit, which is a measurement, and it's a measurement that's about 18 inches. So here's what he just said. Which of you, by worrying, can add 18 inches to the distance of your life? Now, that's not very far, is it? And the answer is nobody can. Now, we think we can. Right, we think we've got that ability. So this is really for the people. I guess you could say maybe verse 27 is in there, not so much for the people who go through the supermarket aisle and think, ooh, I'm not eating the sexiest food and drinking the sexiest drink. What they're thinking is, let me get the health magazines which say I shouldn't be eating that and should be eating that because then my life will be longer. No, it won't. Your life will not be one inch longer than Jesus has already determined. You understand this? You will die at a predetermined time. The Bible says his days are, your days are in his hands. Before you were born, he knew every one of them. He knew when you would drop dead. So you're going to die. You're welcome, right? So, but here's what he's saying. He's saying, so look, that's fine. If you want to eat kale, if that's your deal, you want to do paleo, you want to dip your body in essential oils, you want to do CrossFit, you do all that, that's good. But you're not going to live any longer. Right? Do you understand that? Like Jesus didn't go, okay, Chris is going to be born, now let's watch him. Oh, he's a good eater. 10 more years. Right? No. Chris, you're born on this day. You're dying on this day. Now, might I live a healthier life? Sure. Might I have a more productive? Sure. Like, all those things are true, but am I going to live longer? No. Like, not one inch longer is my life. So do all that. No. So is he saying, well then I guess just whatever, just eat, drink, be merry, eat Twinkies, sit on the couch, don't, you know, just gorge your body? No, he's not saying that either. He's simply saying that's not going to add to the length of your life. Now, we think it will, right? I think that if I jog enough, I'm actually going to lengthen my life. It's not going to. Joggers still die and have heart attacks. We think that if we will just make sure as the kids are walking out the door with the car keys, you're like, oh, be careful. That if I don't actually say be careful, they could get in a terrible fiery accident. It's the fact that I said be careful, and I worried about them. And if they don't get an accident, whew, good. I probably saved their life. And Jesus is saying no. So here's his point. He's not being a Debbie Downer. He's not saying, wah, 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 you're all going to die. It's not that. He's saying this. You're going to die, and you're going to die at a time God already told you you're going to die. So why are you wasting your time? Like, why is this consuming so much of you? You're not going to add an inch. I mean, it's amazing. Like, on the road of life, boom, you're going to drop dead right when God says you're going to, and you're not going to extend it. You're not going to leap over to 18 inches. That's like less than a step, right? It's not going to happen. The fourth thing he says is, Christian, your anxiety is really just a symptom of worldly ambitions. So look at verse 31. Therefore, don't be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things. Okay, so here's the idea. Verse 31 encapsulates the ambitions of Gentiles. And Gentiles in Scripture, what he's referring to are people outside of Christ. They're not followers of Jesus. They're non-Christians. Let's say it that way. And this represents their ambitions. So he says, this is what they're going after. Their value system says this is ultimate. This is the thing I ought to be pressing towards. This is what I'm seeking after. And Jesus says this, if you seek after, if your values are the same as the world, if you're seeking after the same things the world seeks after, then you will have the same anxieties that the world has. And what's the point of the Sermon on the Mount that we've said all along? What's the title of this whole sermon series? Keep Christianity Weird. We're different. And what he means by that is we're not just freakish people out in culture. He means, although we are becoming more and more so, aren't we? He means that everything, our emotions are different. What we desire is different. What we seek after is different. Our hearts, our motives are different. And he's saying right down to this. I mean, are these your ambitions? I got to keep up with the Joneses, what I eat, what I wear. I mean, these become this ultimate thing for me. He says, then you're going to feel the same anxieties that they feel. That's why you shouldn't be worried. Number five, he says, Christian, your Father knows you need all those things. Look at the end of verse 32. He says, why not seek after all these things? Your Father knows. I know he's a good dad. And what is worry? Worry is basically saying, God won't carry this. God isn't as good as he said he is. He's not as sovereign as he said he is. He's not as gracious as I thought he was. So I have to worry about this. Instead of backing up and going, no, he's good and gracious and righteous and merciful and loving and caring, and he's the dad you always dreamed of who will step into your life and say, I got this. I know you need it. I know you need to be fed tonight. I know your basic necessities. I know what you're needing, and I will provide it for you. I know what you need more than you know what you need. And I'm going to provide it for you. You see this? I know what you need. But lastly, he says, Christian, your anxiety is incompatible with common sense. Skip down to verse 34. He sort of summarized everything. Therefore, don't be anxious about tomorrow. Tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble, right? In other words, there will be troubles. Jesus isn't saying there's going to be no problems in the Christian life. So you can just live this carefree, la-di-da, no, I have no issues. I can just sort of float through life. No, he's saying you may have troubles today. I get that. But troubles tomorrow, you can do nothing about. You cannot solve the problems of tomorrow. See, what worry is this. Worry is saying it might happen or it might not happen. It's saying I'm concerned about something I can't control, but worry, 99% of worry most of us know by experience is a fantasy. It never actually, our worries never actually materialize. Right, so we worry about our kids. We lay awake at night about our job. We're concerned. We take medication to control some things. We do all these things, and we realize, some of us, later on down the road, you know what? Why did I have so many sleepless nights over that worry? It never actually materialized in my life. Why was I so concerned? This is Jesus' point. It doesn't make sense. It's incompatible with common sense. It's a waste of time. God cares. He will provide for you. He knows your needs. Are you comfortable that there is a God who knows your needs better than you do and will provide every single one of your needs? Are you good with a God like that? Who says if you don't need that car, you need this one. You don't need that neighborhood, you need this one. I need you next to these people in the office, not that one. I mean, are you comfortable that a God that sovereignly determines those kind of boundaries of your life and says, I know what you need and I'm going to provide what you need? And I can rest in that? Now, let me pause there just for a second. Because one of the things I want to be careful of is that we don't take all of this, God will provide, God's got your back, you know, everything's going to be okay, that sort of thing, and come up with some wrong applications. Because there are wrong ways that you could apply this. You could go in some terrible directions with this, and I want to make sure you don't go there, okay? So let's talk about some wrong applications that you could somehow decipher from this. And the first wrong application is that Christians are exempt from working to earn a living. That is, that you think I don't have to work, right? I can just sort of sit at home. Like, remember the story of Elijah? He's down by the river and he's starved, and so God sends the ravens to feed him. Remember this story? It's in Kings, I believe, and that's going to happen one time. It'll never happen to you, okay? That is not your story. So this is not permission for you to sit in your lazy boy and recline and sit at home and not do anything and binge watch Netflix and House of Cards or whatever, right? That's not permission for you to do that. You look. Remember what he said? Look at the birds of the air. Look at them. How does God provide for them? If you just go home today and journal about the bird you're watching. And I promise you, you're not going to say, it's amazing. He went to the nest, hung out, didn't do anything. A hand from heaven with bird seed came down. And he ate to his heart's content, and then it went back up into the clouds, right? No. You know what God says? Little bird, I'm going to give you wings. And little bird, I'm going to fill my creation with food. I'm going to fill it with provision. Now go get it. See, this is us. Chris, I'm going to give you arms and legs. I'm going to give you a mind and eye. I'm going to equip you with skills and abilities and all these kind of things. Now I've got this world that I told Adam and Eve that be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it, which means there's all this untapped potential out there in this creation that I've said to you as the pinnacle of my creation, human being, I've told you, you go out and you work hard and you make something and you provide. This is the means by which I'm going to provide for you 99.9% of the time. So it doesn't mean you don't work. But the second wrong application would be to say that Christians are exempt from caring for others. All right, but we don't talk like this. In fact, this is the way so often that God provides for our needs. We don't look and say, well, God said he'd provide for them, so good, awesome. I don't have to give anything. I don't have to put any money in the offering. I don't have to help out somebody in my growth group. I don't have to try to get Pastor Lou to go different parts of the world through my financial support. I don't have to, somebody else will, or God will. God's just going to reach down and miraculously provide all the needs. No, because what does the Bible say over and over and again? But the way God provides for needs is through the blessing of others. Paul says to the Philippians, you Philippians know how when I was in Thessalonica, like on my own, like you sent me help for my needs once and again, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God. And my God will supply all your needs according to his riches and glory. How will that happen? Money pours down from heaven. No, somebody else is going to provide for you, Philippians. So Jesus is going to tell a parable at one point where he's going to say, there's going to come this day where God gathers before him all the peoples of the earth, and he's going to put believers and unbelievers, sheep and goat, wheat and tares. And he's going to say to the people of God, he's going to say the same thing to both of them, in some ways to both of them. He's going to say to this group, he's going to say, you know what? Well done, because you know what? When I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. When I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. When I was naked, you clothed me. I was in prison, you visited me. And they're going to say, when did this happen? I don't remember that, Jesus. When you did it to others, you did it to me. That's how God provides. So we can't say we don't have to work. We can't say that we don't have to provide for others, but we also can't say that we're exempt from experiencing trouble. That would be wrong. We are. We're going to have trouble. But trouble is different than worry. He says, don't worry, but there will be trouble. In fact, he says, sufficient to today are the trouble of its own, right? There's going to be troubles. In this world, you will have trouble. You will. Not might, you will. But he says, be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. Be of good cheer, that if your trouble goes all the way to your death, if your trouble is ISIS taking your head from your shoulders, I've even overcome that. And they can't take it away from you. But now, he says to us, okay, so here's the one conclusion I'm drawing. Don't be anxious. But now I want you to see, he gives us one remedy. I mean, this is the killer app for anxiety. Ready? Verse 33. He says, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. That's it. I mean, this is him saying, this is the anxiety killer. Now, if I could summarize for you the big idea of verses 25 to 34, I would say it this way. Don't be anxious, seek first the kingdom. Now, you see, now, he says, don't, but seek first. In other words, listen to me just for a second. He's setting these things in opposition to each other. He's saying, if you have this one, you won't have this one. If you don't have this one, you will have this one. In other words, one of the ways that you remedy anxiety is by seeking first. One of the ways that you have anxiety is by not seeking first. It's a question of ambition. It's a question of priority. What do you seek first? What gets first position in your life? Because if it's anything less than God, if it's food, if it's drink, if it's clothing, if it's your body, if it's something other than God that gets first position, you will feel anxiety. You will worry all the time. I don't look good enough. I'm not wealthy enough. I don't have the right clothes. I'm not eating the right foods. Whatever it is. He says he did not say, don't buy clothes. Don't get food. Don't get drink. Don't care for your body. He doesn't say that. He says, just make sure it's in the right priority. Make sure you put it where it needs to go. Do you see that? Seek first, because if you don't, then none of these, nothing falls into place. He's saying, you put what goes in first place, and all these things just have a way of sort of finding where they should be in priority in your life. Listen to how David says it, Psalm 43. Why are you cast down, O my soul? He's preaching to himself, which we need to do a lot. And why in turmoil within me? Why are you in turmoil? What's turmoil? What's another name for turmoil? Anxiety, worry, concern. What's cast down? Depression. I'm upset. Why? He's asking his heart, why are you there? Have you ever felt this? You get up in the morning, why are you there? Why could I not sleep last night? Why is there a turmoil in my heart this morning? What is it that's going on? You know what David says, the remedy? He says, hope in God. You know why you're there? You know what? Because you have displaced God. You have displaced, you put your priorities wrong. And so daily, moment by moment, this is not an easy thing to do. When Jesus says, don't be anxious, he's not saying, yes, it's easy. He says, don't be anxious. He's saying, seek first. To the degree you're not seeking first, is the degree you're not hoping in God, is the degree that you're going to worry and be anxious. And so you do this every day of your life. It's amazing. You feel anxiety, right? What does that anxiety say? Let's say I feel anxiety about student debt. And it's sitting there in front of me, and it feels massive, and it feels awful, and it feels like a weight in the pit of my stomach. And I look at that, and what's happening? I'm saying in my mind, if I could solve that problem, my whole life would be better. No, your debt will be gone. Good. But that doesn't solve your life. What happens if I go, God? Soul, put your hope in God. Your hope isn't in having zero debt. Your hope isn't in being, you know, having a spouse. Your hope isn't in the career you've dreamed of. Your hope isn't any of those things. Your hope is in God. And the Bible says hope in God will never disappoint you. Hope in anything else will. Don't be anxious. Seek first. And that seeking, by the way, that's why I say it this way. That seeking is in a verb tense that means keep on seeking. Make this something that you seek for the rest of your life. In other words, I don't just seek that one time, Christian. I seek it over and over. I'm going to get up tomorrow morning. There's going to be anxieties in my day. Guess what I have to do? If I don't take and say, hope in God, God is your hope, seek first the kingdom, this is where it's amazing. But when I do, then it's like Paul. Paul says that we take our anxiousness and we bring it to God through supplications, through prayers, through thanksgiving. And then guess what happens? The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. Isn't that exactly what we're looking for when we have anxiety? Anxiety is turmoil of soul. We're saying, oh God, I want the peace of God. Then come, cast your anxieties on me. Bring them to me. Tell me, Daddy, I'm worried about this. What are you worried about? Like right now, do you understand that? In this moment, in this room, right now, you can bow your heads and you can say, Jesus, I'm worried. I've got this concern. I give it to you. I hope in you. Take it. And the Bible says, not it might happen, the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. If you're hoping in God, if God's in the seek first position, there will be peace in your heart. Anything else will be turmoil. Have you put your hope in God? Christian, do you need to put your hope in God again and again and again? If you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ, have you put your hope in God through Jesus Christ? Because really, that's the ultimate question of your life. Where's your hope? What are you seeking? We're all seeking something. Seek first the kingdom. Let's pray. Father, we love you. And I thank you for your word, God. I thank you for the promise of your word. And I just pray, God, I pray for my friends in this room, Lord. Lord, I pray for those of us who are followers of Jesus, that God, we would just be reminded again and again and again that our hope is in you. And how often our hope gets misplaced, displaced. And so we find ourselves filled with anxiety and worry. Now, God, I know there's people in this room that don't know you. They might know religion. They might know the fact that they've put their hope in anything but you. And I pray that today that would change. I pray that you'd open their eyes and unstop their ears and give them a heart to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing they might have eternal life, life in his name. And that life would begin today. I pray that they would confess their sins. I pray, God, they would turn from their sin and put their faith in Jesus Christ. And that you would begin to grow that seed into a fruitful plant. We love you, Jesus. We thank you for your goodness, and we thank you for your words to us. And we ask all this in your name. Amen. Amen. Well, listen, if you're here today and you say, Chris, that's me. I don't know Jesus Christ as my Savior. Like I'm religious or I'm not at all, or I just thought being a good guy was the way to do this. Then just hear me. Like there's a personal decision that has to be made for every single person where you come to realize the truth of this, that God created you, that you're accountable to God, but you've turned from him, you've rejected him, you've put your hope in all kinds of other things. And now he's beckoning to you, and he's drawing you to himself, which is going to make you believe, and that's called a conviction of sin, where you're going to feel, that's wrong. This will doom me if I keep going down this path. Or you can turn in faith to Jesus Christ, and that's what he's drawing you to do, and say yes to Jesus. And I believe in you, and I trust in you, and I trust that what you did on the cross was in my place so that I don't have to, because somebody's sins are going to be paid for, and it's either yours, you paying for them on the cross, or I'm going to pay for them for eternity. Jesus, take my sin. And I fall at your feet, and I worship you. And when that happens, you're a Christian. You're a Christian. Because you have put your ultimate hope in Jesus Christ. I pray you'll do that today, okay? I want you to do me a favor. Take this card that Shane talked about. If that's you, you say, I want to make that decision. Down here at the bottom, it says, I want to be a follower of Jesus. Even if you've already filled out, that's okay. Grab another one. Fill that out. Say, I want to be a follower of Jesus. Then walk it out to our black info tent. Hand it to one of our volunteers. It's not our permission to harass you with a lot of phone calls or anything like that. It's just we want to be a resource to you, pray with you, give you a Bible, do whatever. This is our goal in life as a church, is to lead people into a growing relationship with Jesus Christ. It's rooted in the gospel. So now you've heard the gospel, you believe in it, and you begin to grow. We pray that'll start for you today, okay? So do that. We're going to spend the rest of our time, we're going to worship, we're going to just sing two more songs. Ushers are going to come, and we're going to receive, we're going to be served the Lord's Supper. We remember what Christ has done for us, his goodness to us. We do this every single week where we just want to stop and pause and say, thank you, Jesus. Renew our covenant. God, because you provide this for us, you're going to provide everything we need. You provide every spiritual need, every physical need, and this is just a small sample of how you provide for our needs. And so we celebrate that, okay? I love you guys. Let's worship the Lord together.
With a melody, you surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear, but I am a child of God. Yes, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. And from my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. For I've been born again to a family. Your blood flows through my veins. For I'm no longer a slave to fear. But I am a child of God. Yes, I'm no longer.
As I read this prayer, it's going to be on the screen, and we remember God is our Father. He cares for us. And let's pray this. Father, as we continue to worship, we pray that you will quiet our hearts, that we may hear your voice. We pray that you will stir our hearts, that we may more faithfully follow Jesus, and that you will be glorified by the praise and the prayers that we offer you. May our worship today help us to offer our entire lives to you. We pray this, Jesus, in the name of Jesus Christ, who with the Father and the Spirit is one God. Amen. As we sing our final song, church, let's ask God to speak to us this morning from the word that we've heard.
Long ago, before the world breathed its first breath, you spoke. Before the trees and skies, they sang their songs above, you spoke, revealing peace. Long ago, the sins of men were paid with blood of bulls and goats. You spoke through men, through kings, the ancient prophets. Yes, you spoke, revealing grace. So speak to me, my
you love, you're near. Come speak.
and heal, restore, revere. Come speak to me.
Sing that line again, church. Please come.
Please come and heal, restore, revere. Come speak to me.
I'll sing it again one more time. Please come.
Please come and heal, restore, reveal. Come speak to me.
You know, it's, we are all in need of God to come heal us of the anxiousness we feel each day, casting our cares to Him, seeking Him first. So every church, just take a moment, 1 minute, close your eyes. Before we leave here today, I think we must just say, God, you see us, you hear us, and we just ask you to take our cares and take our anxieties and take our worries, because there's nothing we can do about them. So take 1 minute, just cast your cares on Jesus. He sees, he hears, he's come to heal, to restore each of us who are broken, which is all of us. So take a minute, just cast your cares on Jesus, your anxieties. God, we give you our cares, our anxieties. We know and we trust you. We are here to remind ourselves that you care for us and that you know what's going on in our lives. And so, God, with faith in you, we put our anxieties and our worries, and we lean into you, into not our own understanding, but into you, Jesus Christ. We love you. Continue to speak to us as we go from here, Father. Speak to us from your word from Matthew 6 as we even leave here. Continue to speak to us by the power of your word through Jesus Christ. We love you, God. It's in your name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Well, mothers, have a great Mother's Day. Everyone else, invite your friends and family with you next weekend. And we'll see you guys back here next week. Have a great day, guys.